Howdy. You can call me Jack. It's not my real name, but that's what I'll go by for now. I assume that the time has come to tell my story, and believe it or don't, here it is. Now, before we go into this, I suggest you simply take the lessons away that it teaches. Even if you dismiss it like complete bullshit, as, you know, the other stories that are on the internet. But just understand that there is more truth to this story than any one of you could know. So try not to dismiss it so quickly. Now, understand that I've been out of high school for a good 3 years. But that's when this particular event takes place, so I'm gonna have to wind back my clock a little bit here to tell the story. Originally, for my first 2.5 years of high school, I attended a nice little tight-knit community and school in the deep southern part of America, close to the Gulf. We had all kinds of ghost stories growing up there, and if there was one lesson that my super conservative parents taught me, was this: don't go fooling around in things that you don't understand. Now, that was really the lesson of every horror story, and to be honest, everything that you can find on this site too. But nonetheless, just take it as is. Now, I was really unpopular at my school in the South. For my first 2 years of high school, it was a real big pain because I was a big dork. Everyone made fun of me. And to be honest, I probably brought that on myself. I was a loner, and all I really did in class was play my Game Boy in the back, mouth off to my teacher, and flip off to stoners, because to be honest, messing with stoners is kind of funny. But nonetheless, all I would do after that is rush home and play MMO that I was addicted to. All of that changed during my junior year when my mother's job moved us out west. I started to attend a little Catholic high school with no more than 250 students. It was at that time when I finally started to fit in and make friends. No one here knew how much of a dork I was, so this gave me the perfect opportunity to hide my power level, as they tend to say on /A. And I was able to try to make friends for once in my life. And who knows? Maybe I could even score myself a cute little girlfriend if I was careful. I started to meet people at the school, and at that school it was very tiny, and eventually you start to know everyone in your class. Again, I just loved these small, tight-knit communities where everyone knows everyone, because you can't really afford to hate anyone. My first day, I made a new friend named Sam, and at lunch too, so I opted to sit with him and his friends. He told me about all the other kids at school, who was popular, who were the jocks were, so on and so forth. But what he also did is that he introduced me to his friends too. Jim, a big joyful friend who tipped the scales at about 300 pounds. Vogelman, our table's resident computer nerd and hacker. And then we had the coolest of them all, a musician who happened to play the coolest instrument of them all, the electric guitar. I also met Stephanie, the school's resident spunky Asian girl. Some guys said that she can be a complete and utter bitch, but she seemed cool enough, and she was into gaming and never really messed with any of us, so why'd I have any reason to hate her? And as I stated before, you don't really have room to hate anyone, and you just can't. She even seemed to think that I, me of all people, were funny. So maybe that's why she started to call me at home after school on some days. Sam told me all kinds of stories about her, like how she used to make snacks for the guys at school, but then sprinkled in some Viagra or pour some laxatives into them. And anyone who ate it would suffer the brunt of her painful and arguably cruel joke. I just juggled myself and politely declined whenever she offered anything. Then there was Rottenbacher. His real name was Jason, but everyone called him Rottenbacher, or the Kraut, because he was a hardcore Nazi. He was an outcast, a loner, and no one wanted to be associated with him. Every day he'd wear this red swastika armband to school, just beneath his jacket so the teachers couldn't see. But whenever he'd get hot and slip it off, that weird musty old jacket, or whenever he was changing in the locker room, he'd be seen wearing the same red Nazi armband. Furthermore, on Halloween and school costume events, when he knew he could get away with it, Reinbacher always wore an entire replica of an SS uniform like what the Gestapo wear, with a black hat, boots, and all. It was a mean and angsty son of a bitch. Whenever anyone told the teacher about him or asked him about the Nazi stuff, he'd just shoot racial and ethnic slurs at them, cuss them the hell out, and then scream, "Hail Hitler!" However, I'm pretty sure that last part was done in an attempt of a vain inside joke about himself. Furthermore, one particular thing that caught my eye, that I couldn't help but notice, that Reinbacher always walked with a slight limp, like he was in pain. Sam told me that somebody once saw him tightening a light barbed cilice in the locker room, like the ones that those old Catholic priests used to wear to punish themselves for their own sins. It was a Catholic school, so like most people, I just assumed that he just wore the cilice because he was a devout Christian. It was kinda strange, though, for a hardcore Hitler lover like Reinbacher. But it was high school, and none of us preferred to think of stuff like that. After he got done introducing me to everyone, Sam told me about some of the school's old stories, including a particular urban legend that circulated about Kaylee, a girl that died mysteriously after playing some sort of cell phone game. Sure enough, he could point the girl out of the yearbook, and everyone recalled when the police had declared her missing under mysterious circumstances. She was then presumed dead almost immediately thereafter. If you asked anyone exactly what happened, no one could tell you a goddamn thing. They would always just tell you that it was because she played a cell phone game. Sam, my best friend. Stephanie, the cute, mischievous Asian. Reinbacher, the self-torturing Nazi. A police's investigation of a teen's disappearance. And of course, the actual cell phone game. All these people and events and things are about to come together and drag me into something I wish I had no part. It wouldn't even be until about over two years later that I finally understood how and why everything went the way it did. Anyway, the last half of our junior year came and went, and a long summer passed us by in what seemed like a heartbeat. It was finally time to begin our last year of high school. Everyone was back for the new school year, pumped and ready to start the laziest, most fun year of our high school lives. Even Reinbacher, still limping around to school in his barbed cilice, was still spouting his Nazi garbage every time someone decided to mess with him. However, even as he was yelling his Nazi crap, I can still feel that he seemed a little bit happier than usual. The year started out eerily quiet. Word around was that a few more cell phone game related disappearances had happened over the summer, one to a boy and one to another girl from another high school. The police were also investigating a possible serial killer. According to the paper, the only common link was that the police could manage to find is that every person who had disappeared had received a text message that read, "Welcome to the game." None of the text messages had been sent from the same cell phone, so the evidence was dismissed as circumstantial. For me, though, things weren't half bad. It was this year when I finally started to open up more as a person, and finally had made a good circle of friends whom I trusted and felt more calm about being myself. Gradually, I started to fit in more and more, and pretty soon I was pretty popular in certain circles. Stephanie liked to hang around me more and more because of how funny she thought my jokes were, although I can't really say they are that funny looking back now. Before long, one day, which I still remember as one of the happiest days of my life, she came to me in the middle of a campus, in the middle of the campus after the school had locked up. And it was just me and this beautiful Asian girl and her eyes looking up with her long black hair and that smile I could just die for. She asked me right then and there, "Jack, will you go out with me?" I laughed and ran and jumped for joy. "Of course I will," I said, and I started to dance around her in front of everyone. I finally had a girlfriend, and I still remember that as one of the happiest days of my entire life, if not the happiest. We went on dates and we hung out after school, and she even started to eat lunch with Sam, Jim, and Vogelman, and I every day. Maybe I would have been so happy if I had known what was going to happen next. It was one day at lunch when she was sitting with us, when she mentioned that while sleeping over with one of her friends one night, they had stayed up late with some girls from another high school, talking about the cell phone game. She said that these girls knew all about the rules of the game, and they had explained it all to her in great detail. Supposedly, you could join the game at any time just by sending a message at midnight to the right phone number. The text message is supposed to say, "I wish for the power to curse." If you did it right, you would get a message in return saying, "Welcome to the game." And supposedly, this is the reason why, you know, for why the police found that message on all the phones of everyone who disappeared. Stephanie went on to talk about the game. We all listened intently to what she was saying. She told us that once someone was in the game, they were in danger. Within 2 weeks, they had to complete one number of different tasks, or else they would be dragged away in the middle of the night. I stopped her right there. And then I said, "Dragged away? By what? To where?" She got silent for a moment and then said, "I don't know," she whispered before continuing her story. She said that in order to protect oneself from being dragged away, you could do one of two things. The first is that you could find a special protective item. The item could be anything. You never know what it's going to be. But it seemed that whatever that item was, it would make the bear suffer in some way. This was considered a small price to pay in return for protection, as long as you wore the item. The second way was to bring someone else into the game. This could be done by sending a text message saying, "Welcome to the game," to someone else's phone. If that same person received a text message from someone else who was in the game, that meant that that person now is in the game too, and subject to all the same rules and consequences of the game. If the person didn't find a protective item to protect themselves or bring another person to the game too, they'd be dragged away. The catch about the second was this. While the protective item, if found, could protect you indefinitely for so long as you kept it, bringing someone else into the game would only buy you a temporary grace period. The first time you brought someone into the game, you would get a 2 week extension. Then, only 1 week. Eventually, the grace period would get shorter and shorter until you barely brought yourself any time at all by bringing someone else into the game. By that time, you would have needed to find your protective item. Even though I've always been somewhat of an X-File, I don't like hearing her talk about this stuff, so I told her that it was just a bunch of nonsense. And she replied with, "Really think so?" she asked. "If it's true, it would explain what the police had found, and imagine how cool that would be to curse anyone you messed with, bringing them into the game. You could get rid of anyone, and no one would ever know." There was an edge into her voice that I hadn't heard from before. She almost sounded intoxicated at the thought of it. Truth be told, it scared me a little. "Don't go talking like that," I told her. Stuff like that's beyond you and me. We shouldn't go messing with stuff like that. What if you got involved and then it turned out to be true? What would you do if something happened to you? Promise me you won't go messing with stuff like that. She gave me a funny look. I thought you would never be the kind of person to get so scared of silly things like this, Jack. Well, Stephanie, I don't think it's right to mess around with stuff that you don't understand, you know? Now promise me, Steph, promise me you won't try it. She sighed in annoyance, but reluctantly agreed. Fine, fine. I won't play the scary cell phone game, Jack. You happy now? I told her that I was, but truth be told, I was scared. I didn't believe her. In all the time I'd known her, I'd never seen her betray anyone or sleep around or anything, but she always had been a trickster and a liar. And she would lie to anyone about anything if it got her ahead, as long as it didn't hurt anyone else. But to be honest, I thought it was kind of cute and just accepted it as one of her quirks, but this time it was serious. So a few days later, when she came back and told us that she had joined a cell phone game, I was pissed. What were you thinking? You promised me you wouldn't do that. Yeah, I know. It's not a big deal, all right? I've already got it planned out. Besides, if it's true and it works, it's too good of an opportunity to pass up. She just held her phone up and looked at me with a giddy smile. Look! The text message was open, and the screen read, "Welcome to the game." Kind of freaky, huh? I got it just after midnight, just like the girl said. My jaw dropped. My heart sank. I was speechless, and I was scared stiff. This game, it couldn't be for real, could it? Stephanie, if this is real, you're in danger now. You've only got 2 weeks to find a protective item. I know, and that's why I sent a text to Rebecca. I'm gonna find out if it's true or not. I hit the roof. You did what? But Stephanie, if this is real, that makes you just as good as a murderer. You cursed Rebecca, and now she could die because of you! Jack, relax. I don't actually believe in any of this stuff. And if I did, Rebecca's always been being such a big-time bitch, it's not like she doesn't have it coming anyway. She giggled with that same mischievous giggle of hers that I've always loved, but this time I wasn't loving any part of it. A couple weeks had passed and nothing happened. But then one day, Rebecca didn't show up to school. At lunchtime, Stephanie was sitting around us, as usual, when the assistant principal came to tell us. When the assistant principal came to talk to us with a megaphone.
May I have your attention, please?
Everyone just got silent.
The police had reported that one of your fellow students, Rebecca, has gone missing.
Stephanie's golden skin turned white as she froze.
Her parents are worried about her. If any of you know about this, please come and talk after school. That is all.
Stephanie. Oh, fuck. Stephanie. I whispered, then spoke up with a slightly louder tone than the second one. At this point, I was very afraid of her. I was very afraid of what she might do. She looked at me and said, "Don't." Jack, I don't say anything. Just don't. She got up and bolted from the lunchroom. I chased after her. Stephanie! Stephanie, what are you doing? She kept jogging away from me, her cell phone out. Don't try to stop me, Jack! I'm going to survive! I need more time! If I can get another week, I can curse someone else, and then they'll give me 3 weeks to find it! Stephanie, listen to yourself! Who are you going to curse? If you kill someone else for a little extra time... Look! Look what's already happened to you! She started to cry. I know, damn it! But I know who I'm gonna curse. No one's gonna miss him, I promise. Stephanie, that is not right. You can't do this. No one deserves this. Let me help you. We could find that protective object for you together. She turned and showed me her phone. Her outbox had a message which read, "Welcome to the game." She had sent it to Rottenbacher. I began to weep. Oh, God. I grabbed her and held her as tightly as I could. Stephanie. Stephanie. I love you. I'm so sorry. This isn't right. None of this is right. She held on to me and began to cry deeply as well. We held each other for nearly an hour like that. Still remember it like it's yesterday. Then that night. That night before we went home, we both resolved that we'd start looking for that protective object the next day. The next day came, and I was walking with Stephanie along a track after school. That's when Rottenbacher approached us with a cell phone. He was furious. He held it up to her face. Is this your idea of a joke? You stupid slanted-eyed bitch! Truth be told, I felt Rottenbacher had the right to be a little angry. Sure, he was a Nazi pervert freak, but with all the whispers of murders going around, I could have imagined anyone being angry about getting a text like that. But even so, I wasn't about to let anyone talk to my girl that way. Hey, buddy, watch your mouth. That's no way you talk to a lady. A lady? Rottenbacher shouted. This fucking slut is not a lady. She's a bitch. And she tried to fucking kill me. I bet you killed that other girl too, didn't you? Rebecca? Yeah, she's missing because of you, isn't she? Stephanie began to cry, and I pulled back, and I punched him as hard as I could. Right at Rottenbacher's face. He stumbled backwards a few steps, and grabbed his lip, which was trickled with a little stream of blood. But he kept his composure. I halfway expected him to swing back, but he just stood there. But after a moment, he spoke. You don't get it, Stephanie, do you? I'm already in the game. I've always been. I know the fucking score, but unlike you, I never curse anyone else. Bullshit, I said. If all that's true, how are you still? Suddenly, I remembered the Silas Rottenbacher wore around his leg. Caused him to limp in agony. And what Stephanie had told me at lunch. Whenever a new protective item is discovered, whatever it was, it would bring the bearer to suffer. You have a protective item, don't you? You have one! Stephanie's eyes lit up. It was clear that we'd both realize the same thing. Rottenbacher smirked. That's right. So I figured out that your girlfriend better know that she's not getting any additional time from cursing me. I've already been there and done that, and I paid my dues, friend. Stephanie looked up at him with fear in her eyes. Days passed, and try as we might, Stephanie and I couldn't find anything that would qualify as a protective item. We were approaching the two-week deadline when she was looking more and more scared by the day. Her hair was a mess. Her usually bubbly personality was glum and distraught. She stared into the space during class and prayed constantly. After the two-week deadline passed, we were both terrified. She came to me at school and said, Jack, I want you to sleep with me tonight. Just to stay with me all night. Don't let it get me. I couldn't refuse. So, I showed up at her house that night and came through a window. We slept together, and to be honest, it was bittersweet. She went to sleep holding me, but I lay awake most of the night, watching and waiting until I finally fell asleep at 4 in the morning from sheer exhaustion. The next day, I woke up, and all I could think was, Stephanie! I looked around frantically. She wasn't in the bed next to me. Stephanie! I said louder. I climbed out of the bed and began to search for her. I walked in her kitchen. And there she was. Don't be so loud, a voice said. Indeed, it was Stephanie. I turned around to see her sitting at the round table in the kitchen. She was smiling and as giddy as ever. I breathed a sigh in relief. My parents have already gone to work, but I don't want my neighbors getting suspicious and saying something. I wept in relief. It was over. She was safe. Nothing had come for her. I ran across the kitchen floor and hugged her and kissed her all over. Everything was perfect. At least it was for 2 weeks. Then I came to school one day and none of her classmates had disappeared, including Sam. Everyone was in an uproar. No one known what happened to them or where they had gone. No one except for me and the person that had done it. Stephanie, if the amount of time expanded was halved by each time you brought someone into the game, then 9 people would have brought her just over 2 weeks. Which meant that her time was running out. It was gonna be over tonight. I confronted her about it after school. Stephanie, the police are getting suspicious. You can't do this anymore. I can't watch you do this anymore. It's evil. She looked at me silently. But I still remember the look in her eyes that day. At this point, it became clear to me that that girl, the girl that I had once known and loved, was long gone, and all that remained was a soulless, wicked shell which clung to life. And the only thing that kept her alive was that fear for death. More than anything. But even so, I loved her. I loved her. More than anything, she was my first and my only girlfriend, and I couldn't let her go. I couldn't let anything happen to her, not in this way. It's okay, she said. I won't do it anymore. I accepted what I needed to do, and I'm going to do it. No one else is going to die because of me. Stephanie? Are you sure? Maybe we can still find a protective item. If we look now... She looked down sadly. No, Jack. There is no running from it now. I just want to spend one more night with you. One more night together. That's all I want. Can I please have that, Jack? I was heartbroken. Everything was too melancholic. Everything was too melodramatic. I was so sad at hearing those words. At the thought of her being taken away. I threw up. I vomited. I retched over and over again into a nearby garbage, trying to fight back the endless stream of tears. That night, she slept with me again. Sick, weak, and tired, I passed out of pure exhaustion at 3 a.m. Less than an hour later, I awoke with a start. Stephanie was gone. I sat up and I looked around in terror. I found a note and I read it. Jack, I'm sorry for lying to you again, but I'm not gonna die yet. A chill went down my spine. I continued to read. I figured out what I needed to do, Jack. Don't worry, I promise no one else is gonna die because of me. What could she be thinking? I looked around my room, and suddenly I noticed that my .45 caliber pistol that my father had bought for me for my 18th birthday was missing from my room. Everything had made perfect sense at that point. That's why she wanted to spend a night with me tonight. She wanted my gun. She was planning to go out to Rottenbacher and take his protective item. As fast as I could, I threw on some clothes, bolted from my truck, and I sped off towards Rottenbacher's apartment. When I got there, the lock had been shot off and there were voices that were there inside. I pushed the door open. What's going on in here? I demanded. I looked around. Stephanie was holding Rottenbacher at gunpoint with my .45. The apartment walls were covered in pictures of Adolf Hitler and swastika banners. There were whips and chains scattered around the bedroom floor. Rottenbacher was stomping around in long-sleeved pajamas, cursing her in his typical neo-Nazi form, screaming about home invasion and calling the police. And this and that. He even was wearing that stupid Nazi armband. It was obvious this guy was a lunatic and a fanatic. Stephanie screamed at him, "Shut the fuck up!" She fired a round into the wall behind him. And winced. I remember my ears were ringing from the loudness of that gunshot. The sharp pain in my inner ear was too tense to worry about it at that moment. Now give me that barbed torture thing you are always wearing, or I'll kill you right here, right now. Her voice had malice. Rottenbacher stood in place for a moment and slowly began to remove his pajama leggings. You're making a big mistake, he said. You should just accept the things are and die with dignity. You're not going to get away with this. He removed the syllus from his leg, from which he trickled a small amount of blood and then handed it to her. Immediately, she slipped onto her own leg with one hand, fumbling with my pistol as she tightened it until it hurt. And her own leg began to bleed a little. Let's go, Jack, she whispered and turned to leave. I started to walk out with her from the apartment. I heard Rottenbacher shouting, You won't get away with this! You stupid, slanted-eyed fucking cunt! He's gonna come after you, you know! He's gonna drag you off to hell where you belong for what you done. You're gonna pay for all those kids you killed! I could see that she was sobbing a little as we walked away. I was sick. I was disgusted with everything I was doing. I was disgusted with Stephanie for being so cruel and selfish, and I was disgusted with myself for seeing all this and letting this happen, for seeing the signs, and not doing a goddamn thing to stop it. But at least now it was over. As we walked back to my truck, I said a small prayer for Rottenbacher, in my hopes they could find a new protective item within 2 weeks. He may have been a racist bastard, but in a way, he was still better than Stephanie. If what he said never about cursing anyone was true, then he didn't deserve to die. He didn't deserve to die for anything he did. I drove to Stephanie's home, and she was exhausted. I would have given her a kiss on the cheek if I wasn't too sick. Sick of this ordeal and sick of her. Good night, I whispered to her. Good night, Jack. I love you, she whispered back. She climbed out my truck and went back into her house, and I started to drive home, exhausted from the day's events. About halfway home, I was falling asleep at the dash, but then suddenly I was woken up by the feeling of my phone vibrating. I picked it up, and it was a call from Stephanie, and I answered, Hello? The first thing I heard was a shriek, followed by the sound of a noise pounding at her door. Jack, it's here! He's coming for me! He's coming for me! What, Steph, hold on! I pulled a U-turn on my truck, and I sped right back towards her home. Stephanie was becoming more frantic. Suddenly, on the other end of the line, I heard the sound of a door being bashed in, followed by another shriek. I could hear Stephanie screaming at the top of her lungs, and hideous blood-curdling scream. I remember every moment so perfectly, her screams were word for word. No, 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 no! Don't die! Adrenaline was so surging through my heart right now. It was like a force on an accelerator. She screamed. She screamed again, and I heard what sounded like the phone hitting the floor. And Stephanie's screams getting further and further away, and then dead air. Stephanie? Stephanie? Answer me, damn it! Getting no response, I hung up the phone and called the police. When I arrived at Stephanie's house, the front door had been smashed in. I parked my car on the lawn, and I jumped out, carrying my .45 caliber pistol with me. I ran inside, searching the halls. Everything was like it was in slow motion. Then I came to Stephanie's bedroom, and I turned on the light. I checked all the corners with my pistol, leading all the way in. I lowered my gun, and then something caught my eye in the center of the room. Stephanie's cell phone lay on the floor. On the floor of her bed next to her. In the middle of the room, in the carpet, was a very small patch of blood. It could have been more than a few drops, but the most chilling sight of all was at the edge of her bed. From the edge of her bed, of the door, of her room, which led into the hallway, was a trail of claw marks that dug right into the carpet and wood floor. Claw marks that she had left, as if something was dragging her away. Couldn't take it anymore. I turned and left her room, and then on my way out, I couldn't help but notice, but a few teeth left on the floor and a fingernail or two. In fact, as I continued to walk down, I noticed more and more fingernails that lay. It must have been almost all, if not all of her fingernails that lay on the floor. as if she tried so hard. As I walked through the streets, I threw up again. I could hear the sound of sirens coming in the distance. Days passed, then weeks, then months, and the police did their investigations. They questioned me. They questioned me time and time again, and every time my stories were all the same. I told them all the truth. I knew it was unbelievable, and I don't think they believed me, but all the evidence supported my story, and there's nothing to implicate me in any of the crimes, so at length, they finally let me go. Things gradually went back to normal. Our class eventually recovered from the losses of so many of our classmates. And over time, my mind kind of accepted what happened. What had happened until it seemed like a distant dream. I graduated, moved on to college. But there's one thing that was still bothering me through it all. And that's what Brock, and that was Rottenbacher. He had been exactly right. Even though Stephanie had taken his Silas, he never vanished in any way. And the others did. But there's one thing I do know, and that's to this very day. If you ever see Rottenbacher, he's always wearing that red Nazi swastika armband.